This video is brought to you by the Taiwan Excellence Awards.
Excellent!
That's right, Paul. Established in 1992 in, well, Taiwan, the TEAs were created to recognize innovation and value among Taiwanese products like the Acer Predator X34 that I'm reviewing today. Exceptional items are selected for their robust R&D, design, quality, and international marketing. These awards epitomize the state's ability to use innovation to create added value in the design and manufacturing of cutting-edge products. You can find more info about the Taiwan Excellence Awards and their products in the descriptions below. What's up, guys? So about 1 year ago, Acer released a premium monitor that was critically acclaimed by numerous reviewers to be the best gaming panel to ever hit the market. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to snag one for review at the time, and after many dead ends, I eventually gave up all hope of ever seeing one arrive on my doorstep. Until it did! 12 months after its initial release in the United States, I am finally giving you my review on the Acer Predator X34. Now, in case this thing has somehow flown under your radar for the last year and you've got your credit card at the ready at this very moment, I'm gonna crush your dreams at the start of this video by saying this monitor retails for about $1,300. Trust me, it's better you find out sooner. Granted, the ludicrous price tag may not bother any of you high rollers out there, so at this point, the only thing that matters is what makes this monitor a cut above the rest. Well, firing off the main specs first, we're dealing with a curved 34-inch 21x9 ultra-wide IPS display with a resolution of 3440x1440. The panel sports an advertised gray-to-gray response time of 4 milliseconds, not bad for IPS, and a default refresh rate of 60Hz that's overclockable to 100Hz. Top that off with built-in G-Sync support, and it's not hard to see why I am. A quick tour before we get into the fun stuff, the screen's matte finish keeps glare and reflections to a minimum for the most part, and I think the subtle curvature strikes a nice balance between offering an immersive gaming experience and a reasonable landscape for browsing and productivity. Sleek black bezels on the top and sides measure a centimeter in thickness, making their way to a stylized chin bar with super cool branding and underglow LEDs to let your friends know that you paid a lot for this thing. Within the on-screen display, users can switch between LED colors including red, blue, green, orange, white, and my personal favorite, off, as well as a few preset lighting effects. In my opinion, the OSD itself could be much improved here. With the buttons underneath the right side of the panel, it's kind of difficult to know which one you're pressing, which makes it all the more frustrating that the menu navigation is not intuitive at all. Even after getting used to the button layout, it still takes way too many clicks to adjust any given setting. It took me 15 clicks just to overclock the monitor's refresh rate. That's right, you actually use the on-screen display to overclock the refresh rate of the panel. I do like the option for throwing up a refresh rate counter though, along with other settings like pixel overdrive, DTS tuning for the built-in speakers, and user-defined profiles that you can switch between on the fly. The backside of the Predator looks all aggressive and stuff, and I've left my fingerprints on the glossy finish to convey my thoughts on glossy finishes. Supported stand adjustments include lift and 40-degree tilt, 5 down and 35 up. I would have liked to see some swivel action here for sharing the screen with someone in the room, but there is a 100x100 VESA wall mount for those with more specific needs. The stand also features a carrying handle for easy transport and a cable routing hole that I wish had a small break somewhere to pass cables in and out more easily. If you have a small desk like myself, another thing to consider here is that the stand, while gorgeous, has a massive footprint, and since it's kind of designed like a tripod with three legs, it's not like you can just let the base overhang the edge of the desk if you wanted to position the monitor further away from you. So make sure that your desk space isn't just wide enough, but has the proper depth as well. For the rear I/O, you'll find a DC input, 3.5mm audio out, a USB 3 upstream port, and 4 USB 3 inputs. Video outs include HDMI 1.4, which is overclockable to 60Hz, but you'll have to connect to the DisplayPort 1.2 port with a supported NVIDIA card if you want a taste of that G-Sync lifestyle. Now, I've tested out this technology several times on the convention show floor, but being able to set up a G-Sync panel in my own room for the first time, without any crowds or blaring music from the booth next door, looking at you, G-Skill, was so much better, oh my god. Having your monitor's refresh rate dynamically adjust to match your GPU's frame rate is a simple concept to understand, but it really has to be experienced to appreciate the full effect. By completely eliminating the issue of screen tearing that comes with traditional VSync disabled, and stuttering that occurs with VSync on, visibly, there's nothing left to disrupt the rendered frame output, and pairing that with a 100Hz refresh rate for the first time feels like someone dumped a vat of hot lube on your whole gaming experience. Seriously, it's like lube on everything. Gameplay is so smooth it's almost silk-like, and while this goes for any kind of genre, really, fast-paced games like first-person shooters tend to pay the biggest dividends with an enormous reduction in motion blur. Then there's that sexy curve and ultra-wide aspect ratio, which envelops your head and peripheral vision to suck you even deeper into the game, much more effectively, I might add, than a triple display setup. This is of course assuming the game you're playing supports 21:9, otherwise you get these thick black bars on the sides that are kind of annoying, but I'll gladly live with it all things considered. In terms of pixel count, the resolution we're dealing with here is much closer to 2560x1440 than it is to 4K, but to run at high refresh rates you'll still want a high-end GPU, akin to something like the GTX 1070 or better. As an extension of gaming, Twitch streaming with this panel was actually fantastic, with plenty of real estate for things like chat and XSplit, while still allowing me to game at 2560x1440. Ultra-wide at this resolution also works like a dream for general desktop browsing and workstation applications like video editing, though I can see how the screen's curvature might distort the perspective of those looking for pinpoint accuracy with their compositions. Content creators who deal with color correction, on the other hand, will appreciate the IPS display's 100% sRGB color gamut and 10-bit color depth aided by dithering. Luckily, us gamers benefit from these specs as well. Now, when streaming the usual fanfare of online video, Netflix doesn't appear to support 21:9 as of yet, so you're stuck in sidebar city unless you use a browser extension to fill the screen, but that adds a significant vertical crop to your image. However, nothing's worse than getting the sidebars and the cinematic strips on the top and bottom. I've seen arcade cabinets with better looking bezels. At the very least, there is some 21:9 content on the YouTubes that looks pretty damn good, but it seems we're still far from making this a mainstream aspect ratio on content platforms. As for backlight bleed, there are some affected areas in the corners of the screen, but it's minimal enough to go unnoticed in the majority of scenarios. Summing things up here, there's a lot to love about this monitor. The black bars, OSD, and the price are not any of them, but if you're really into PC gaming with a high-end system to boot, this is by far the best gaming monitor I have ever come across, even now, a solid year after its initial release. But that's gonna do it for now, guys, so let me know what you think of this thing in the comments below, and don't forget to toss me a like on this video if you enjoyed it. Before you guys go, check out my store for shirts and stuff, and feel free to follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and Twitch to see what I'm up to, or just say hi. Gets lonely sometimes. As always, thank you guys for watching! Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and I will see you all in the next video.